Hello and welcome to another episode of Skincare Nerds. Today is going to look a little bit different, not because we're still in my house, but because I have someone else joining me today. So we're going to do a little bit of a Q&A. I have Dr. Michelle Wong, who you might know better as Lab Muffin Beauty Science on Instagram and YouTube, joining me to talk all things SPF. So we're talking about misconceptions around SPF, how to reapply it, how formulas have changed over the last decade. So keep watching if you want to see our Q&A with Michelle, and make sure you subscribe and hit the bell button. I'm very excited to be chatting to Michelle today about sunscreens, because I think there are a lot of misconceptions around sunscreen. What are the biggest misconceptions, Michelle, when it comes to sunscreens?
I think the biggest one is probably that a little can go a long way. I think a lot of people say this to make themselves feel better about, firstly, the fact that sunscreen usually has a pretty not great texture going on your skin. And so if you put a little bit, then it can sort of easily disappear. But unfortunately, you do need a lot. On your face, it's about a quarter teaspoon or two finger lengths that you need to have to get the full protection that you see on the bottle. So if you apply, let's say, one finger instead of two, then you're going to get about half whatever the SPF is. With sunscreen, sometimes they have a white cast. And so when you put too much on, your skin might go a bit whiter, and then you have to cover that up with foundation. And it's a bit of a mess. But fortunately, we do have lots of nice sunscreen textures now. And so you should be able to find a sunscreen that works for you, even when you put on two finger lengths or a quarter teaspoon, to get that high protection. Some other misconceptions: chemical and physical sunscreens are different. So they're not that different. You don't need to apply them differently. They do have pros and cons. So chemical sunscreens tend to have a lighter texture. You can get higher protection as well with chemical sunscreens compared to a physical sunscreen. With physical sunscreens, they're less irritating, or they tend to be less irritating. With the newer chemical sunscreens, they're not very irritating at all. There's myths like you have to apply chemical first and physical last, or you have to apply chemical sunscreens 20 minutes before you go outside because otherwise they don't activate. And that's not true. Both of them are active the moment you put them on your skin. You should be waiting like 15 minutes before you go out into the sun anyway, because it needs to sort of flatten out and turn into a nice even coating on your skin. So that way your skin is nice and evenly covered, sort of like paint, so, or icing. Like if you put it on the cake, it sort of has to like settle down a bit before it spreads out.
I love all those facts. That's really helpful. And I love the point that you make on texture, because finding a sunscreen that you really like is sometimes a bit of a challenge. Can you talk a little bit about how formulas have changed over the last decade when it comes to facial sunscreens?
So I think the biggest thing that's changed is the introduction of new chemical filters. So this isn't the case, unfortunately, for anyone watching from America, because your FDA is really slow at approving the new filters. But in Australia, in the EU, in Asia, we have the newer sunscreen filters. Firstly, they're really effective, so you don't need very much to get a high protection. And so that means that formulators have a lot more room to play around with getting a nice texture with the rest of the sunscreen. So that's one of the big drawbacks with physical sunscreens as well, the fact that you do need quite a lot of zinc oxide to get a high protection. And so that means that you have a much chalkier texture. So if you're looking for a nicer texture, these newer organic filters are really, really good for that. The protection factors have gone up a lot. Again, this is because not only with the chemical filters, but with physical as well. Formulators have worked out ways of boosting the protection. There's lots and lots of ways of doing this. So one example is putting in tiny little glass or silica beads into the sunscreen, and this can actually make the sunlight bounce around inside the sunscreen for longer before it gets into your skin. And so when it bounces around for longer, there's more chance for it to be absorbed and turn into harmless heat. Sorry, that was a little bit technical.
Very interesting though.
yeah, there's all these really interesting things, but overall much higher protection. So there was a study in Queensland in the 90s at some point. They were looking at using a daily sunscreen, and they found all these amazing benefits. But if you look at the study, they actually used an SPF 16 sunscreen, which was standard at the time. And so now we look around and we see all these SPF 50 plus everywhere, even with really lovely textures. So yeah, massively boosted protection, which is fantastic for us.
Yeah, I think the excuse that you can't find daily sunscreen is getting a little bit old. There's so many good formulas on the market. Something that I've posted about before is the fact that the SPF in your makeup is not adequate to provide you with enough sun protection. And it's something that people are still shocked by if they haven't heard it before. Can you explain why the SPF in your makeup isn't enough to give you adequate protection?
So in your makeup, if you think about how much makeup you use, you don't use that much. So foundation, maybe one or two pumps, powder, like a tiny amount stays on your skin. With sunscreen, you need to have that quarter teaspoon or two finger lengths on your face to get the protection shown on the bottle. So very roughly, if you use half of that, you get half the protection. With a foundation, you probably use less than a fifth of that. So if you were getting an SPF 50, you're now getting SPF 10 in your makeup. With powder, it's even less, so the amount is so tiny with a powder, unless you purposely put it on and the powder is purposely formulated so that it sticks in a really thick layer on your face, you're just not going to get the right protection. Apart from just getting less protection, you also get less even protection. So one of the things about your skin is that it's not flat. Microscopically, it's like really, really bumpy. So if you think about a cake, again, I really like cake analogies because I just love eating. If you think about a cake and you're icing it, if you take it out of the oven, a lot of the time it's a very bumpy cake. And so you need to put on quite a bit of icing before it flattens out. If you don't put on enough sunscreen, then you're not filling in all the grooves in your skin cake. And so you have little bits sticking out that aren't protected. There'll be some bits that are getting like a full SPF 50 maybe, but most of the bits are getting like zero. So yeah, you need to have enough to get that flat layer, and with makeup, it's just not gonna happen.
What is the best way to apply your sunscreen if you're going to be wearing makeup?
The best thing to do is put on all your skincare. So serums, toners, creams, and then put the sunscreen on top of that. So make sure you don't put too much stuff on underneath because your sunscreen is going to be slightly moisturizing. So you'll probably need to use less moisturizer than you think. And if you have too much on there, like it's just gonna slide around and get really messy. Minimize how much you put on underneath and then put your sunscreen on.
Yeah.
And then it's best to wait a little bit before you put on the makeup. And that's to let the sunscreen settle down and form an even layer. It also forms a more like drier layer. So if you think again about paint, if you let it dry a bit before you put stuff on, then the paint underneath isn't going to move around as much. So you don't have to wait super long, like maybe 5 minutes, go do your hair or go do some chore, like half a chore and then come back and then put on your makeup. So having that waiting time lets it settle down, put the makeup on top as gently as you can. Again, think of it like paint, don't disturb the paint underneath.
Yep, so sunscreen would be your last skincare step and then you'd go in with things like primer and then your foundation, and so your makeup starts from after your sunscreen.
Exactly, yeah. And also there's some sunscreens that work really nicely as primer as well. So the ultraviolet ones I found are actually really nice and they have priming qualities too.
And when it comes to reapplication, how often should we be reapplying and what are the best ways to reapply? Because I've seen so many different tricks. I've seen heaps of things on TikTok lately. What is the best way to do it and how often should we be doing it?
So with sunscreen, it only lasts about 2 hours on your face before it starts decreasing. Like it's not going to just suddenly stop and disappear, but it's about 2 hours before you sort of can't rely on the fact that it's going to be nice and intact and protective. If you're out in the sun all day, then you should be reapplying every 2 hours. And also if you sweat or if you get into the water or if you towel off your face or anything like that, or your body, depending on how much of your skin's exposed. The general recommendation is every 2 hours is important and after any sort of vigorous activity that might shift the sunscreen. If you're getting a lot of sun exposure, I'd recommend wearing as little makeup as possible and just properly going in there with a cream because that's always going to be the best way to reapply. So maybe pack some wet makeup wipes and then wipe off what you have, redo your whole lot. If you're getting a little bit of sun exposure, then I think you have more wiggle room there. So if you're just like walking home or walking to the car after work, if you're reapplying over your makeup and you don't want to mess up your makeup too much, my favorite way is to get a sunscreen and a cotton puff. Now, these are really popular in Asia. They're sort of like a makeup sponge, but really, really flat. And so because they're so flat, they don't soak up a bunch of product.
Right, okay.
So your quarter teaspoon isn't all going into the sponge, it's going on your face.
Yeah.
Plus, you can pack it and carry it around really easily.
In terms of powders, can we get away with using a powder in a generous amount as a touch-up?
I think it really depends. I'm not very convinced that it works as like a proper application technique. So if you're getting serious amounts of sun, I wouldn't rely on a powder. If you're getting a little bit, then I think as a touch-up you can, and I would go for a powder that's purposely designed to stay on your skin. I think they're mostly popular in America, but yeah, I'd go for one of those rather than like a makeup powder that happens to be SPF 50.
Yeah.
Just because, yeah, the makeup powder is going to be formulated to work better as a makeup, whereas a sunscreen powder is going to work better as a sunscreen. There's also sunscreen sprays. Those can work as well, but I'd recommend doing a few layers. So just like a makeup setting spray, you have to get in there a few times to get it everywhere. And make sure you don't breathe it in. So maybe spray it and then walk away so that you're out of the cloud before you breathe again. Because yeah, inhaling sunscreen isn't that great for you.
That's exactly what I was going to ask you. I had someone ask me the other day if there's such thing as a sunscreen setting spray. And I thought you probably can't apply enough for it to be effective, but as a touch-up I guess you can use those spray formulas, but as you said, spray and walk away. Well, thank you so much for joining us today on Skincare Nerds, Michelle. It's been a pleasure to chat to you about SPF, and there is also a video on the do's and don'ts of SPF over on Michelle's channel, so you can go and check that out.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks for tuning in to another episode of Skincare Nerds. I'm sure I'll see you again soon, but if you have any more questions about SPF, leave them in the comments below and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. And don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell button so you don't miss a video from us. See you next time.